Email todayradio@rte.ie.
Now, it's reported in today's Irish Times that Ryanair is selling travel insurance policies on its website, which will be invalid if people fly with the airline for non-essential journeys, while government restrictions on travel overseas remain in force. So as it stands, the official advice from the government is that non-essential journeys overseas should be avoided. Well, to discuss this, I'm joined on the line now by Eoin Corrie, editor of Air and Travel magazine. Eoin, can you just run us through this travel insurance policy that Ryanair is offering on its website?
Welcome to the post-COVID world of travel insurance, where a lot of what was in place is now in question. It's not confined to Ryanair by any case, by any means, Sarah. If you travel to a country that there is an all but essential travel advisory against, travel insurance does not normally apply. But everything has changed because every single country in the world is now subject to that order.
So what does it mean then? If you buy travel insurance from Ryanair and you travel outside of the country, what's your reading of what the travel insurance will cover you for?
My read at the moment is that travel insurance is covering things like that's commoner garden, things like health. The most of what would arise on a trip abroad would be an illness. But what is not being covered is down to the terms and conditions of the different underwriters. And really, it isn't an insurance company like an insurance seller like Ryanair who decides the terms and conditions. It's the underwriters. There are two major underwriters to the travel trade in Ireland, and they have both changed the terms and conditions on March the 15th of what they offer. But most of what they're talking about now is about new policies and whether things like flight disruption will be covered under COVID-19. The notion that you are stranded without cover because your travel insurance, because of the DFA announcement, it's very relevant for long-haul destinations. It's much less relevant for short-haul destinations.
Okay, well, we did actually ask for a Ryanair spokesperson to come on the show, but none was available. However, in the last couple of minutes, we've got a statement from Ryanair and they're rejecting this story in the Irish Times today. They say Ryanair's insurance claims will not be rejected on the basis of the Irish government advisory. In any case, thousands of Ryanair customers are booking flights to travel over the next 12 months, whereas the government advisory is likely to be withdrawn, as it has been in most other EU countries, over the coming days. Well, we don't know that, actually. We don't know if the government advisory is likely to be withdrawn over the coming days. I don't know. Has anyone suggested that?
Yeah, there's obviously huge consultations and lobbying going on in the behind the scenes. And but as you say, there's no direction from the government. In fact, Simon Harris's tweets over the weekend were that all but essential travel is fairly far down the road in terms of his list of priorities.
So where does that leave people if they are planning on taking a flight and taking that big step of flying out of the country from July 1st, whether they get this travel insurance from Ryanair or they get other travel insurance from one of those other companies that you're talking about? Given the government advisory is there on non-essential travel, will they be covered?
That's it's not a quite easy question to answer. Sorry, Sarah, for stumbling on it there.
It's okay.
But let's cut to the chase. The real issue here on your medical cover when you're abroad, the destinations Ryanair flies to, they're all covered under your EHIC card. Where the travel insurance is very important for people is things like having to postpone a trip at short notice, usually death of a relative, something like that. That's where it kicks in, lost luggage, all of those sort of things. It's not clear at all if your bag goes missing on a Spanish trip and the DFA has an all but essential travel marker on it that the insurance company will not pay up. Where I see the conflict is in flight disruption. Almost all the insurance time at the moment is being tied up on flights being postponed, people saying that, for instance, this quandary of the ghost flight to America, where people get on, the flight goes ahead and the airline says, it's not our fault, you weren't allowed into America. That's where all the insurance action is. While Ryanair are selling the travel insurance policy, I don't see much reason for buying it, because because as listeners will identify, the problem with the travel insurance policies in general is not when you're actually buying it, it's when you go to make the claim. And the travel insurance companies, by their nature, start looking for get-out clauses. And that particular advisory from the Department of Foreign Affairs against all but essential travel looks like a pretty big get-out clause from where I'm looking.
So on that basis then, Owen, what do you expect to happen to the travel insurance market after the pandemic? Do you think more people will have it, or is it, as you're saying, maybe a lot of people will decide it's useless?
What has happened is that anyone with an existing policy with flight disruption isn't in your common or garden policy. You generally pay about €15 a year extra for it. Anyone with flight disruption before March the 15th, they're being honoured, or they're likely to be honoured when they get through the backlog. Anything since then explicitly names COVID-19 and says this does not apply for flight disruption. But what I do have an assurance from the major underwriters is that the health aspect of COVID-19 is being covered.
Okay, and just to go back to that Ryanair statement where they say Ryanair's insurance claims will not be rejected on the basis of the Irish government advisory. As you say, it's a pretty big get-out clause. So can Ryanair give that guarantee? Is it a cast iron guarantee, or will it ultimately be down to the underwriter?
It's down to the underwriter, but Ryanair are a big customer. They've got one of the biggest, they've got a website that has more traffic than some of the intermediary, all the big international travel websites. So in the insurance business, in any retail business where money's passes, volume is power, and I suspect Ryanair will have the volume behind them to bring it to negotiations with any underwriter.
Okay, so then if you are somebody who has to travel, would you take out this travel insurance, or is there any particular travel insurance that you could trust to protect you in the best possible way, or what would you be looking for?
I'm a big fan of the annual travel insurance policy that covers all airlines, covers all eventualities that somebody might be interested in. For instance, are you into winter sport, surfing? Are you traveling to North? Everything depends on the USA. The USA health is so expensive. There's a special policy for that. And what I always say is buy it by the 12 month if you're traveling more than once, because it saves a lot of money. But also, the cheapest policy sometimes excludes some very obvious things. I've seen policies that exclude things like a theft of passports and money and handbags, and people have only discovered what's ruled out of your policy when you go to claim. Mm. That's where the big issue is. There are pretty good standard operators in the market, but what is a little bit worrying for the future of travel insurance is the number of get-out clauses that are being inserted by the travel insurance companies because they're panic-stricken. And even more importantly, we've seen across the insurance market, not just in travel in travel insurance, people withdrawing from the Irish market because of other factors such as claims and awards in Irish courts. They're all bigger insurance issues. But I do say get your annual policy. Don't necessarily buy it from Ryanair, because sometimes the same policy can end up being less expensive elsewhere.
Okay, and as you say, read the small print. No matter how boring or time-consuming it might be, do read the small print. Owen, every time we have you on...
It takes a long time, Sarah. It can take 40 minutes to read the terms and conditions.
I've given up a couple of times myself, but it is important. That's the message. Every time we have you on, we get questions on other travel-related queries. I'll just put one of them to you, if you don't mind. This is about Aer Lingus. A listener says, I have accepted a voucher from Aer Lingus, which works out at about €1,000. However, I've been told that you can only use this in one transaction, and if there's balance left on the voucher, you lose it. Can Aer Lingus do that?
I think that it should be transferred. You can't. They're not forcing you to use it in one transaction, and it's also valid for 5 years, which is very high by voucher standards. I would query that with Aer Lingus. Obviously, it would be very unusual if you were told that it would be used in one transaction. Obviously, I haven't seen the individual voucher.
Sure. All right. So take it up with the airline. Owen Carey, editor of Air and Travel Magazine. Thank you very much for joining us this morning.